Thank you very much. I'm glad to see you here. I'll try to make it 20 minutes, 10 minutes questions. For artistic research, the model of the form is exceptionally interesting because it deals with how form and contents intertwine in the physical model and how concrete and abstract interrelate on the plane of consistency. In this paper, I will focus on chapter 2 in the form, titled The Forms in the Soul. Deleuze writes, "We are moving from inflection to inclusion in a subject, as if from virtual to the real, inflection defining the thought, but inclusion defining the soul or the subject. That is what envelops the thought, its final cause and its complete act." End quote. In other words, the theory of the thought is best understood as the progression from inflection to development. Each different form is capturing a certain metaphysical condition. The concept of formings, or the inside of thought, is about reality and virtuality, and how they indiscernibly turn into each other as in a grading scale. Before I continue into the depths of the folds, I want to remind of Deleuze's last word in this chapter to keep a frame of this. "Finally, in order that the virtual can be incarnated or effectuated, is something needed other than this actualization in the soul? Is a realization in matter also required, because the folds of this matter might happen to reduplicate the folds in the soul? The fold is an abstract thinking, but the study can likewise start from the reverse, from fold making. My own entrance into the metaphysics of the fold began with exploring the physical fold making. By letting thoughts coagulate, I freeze the process to a fixed form in order to let a, quote, non-dimensional point between dimensions, and, unquote, be visible. This first series is made as spontaneous events with melted blocks and fabric, wherein natural laws of gravity and matter in conjunction form the folds by themselves. It is an autopoietic method. Along with this theoretical presentation, I will demonstrate the outcome, pictures, but I also brought small models. So I will hand around this. And they also put it in the library, so you can look at the paper. Continue with the metaphysics now. First, one needs to recognize Deleuze's metaphysical ground that derives from Spinoza's two attributes. There exist two attributes, namely matter and thought, in the immanent strata. Corresponding to the attributes in strata, the attributes exist in a parallel realm that Spinoza names the power of the attributes. Let us look at this sketch. Here we have at right, thought, the attribute of thought, and the attribute of matter. And at left, we have the power of attributes, the attribute, the power of thought, and the power of matter. And this side is the actual, or the real, and the other side is virtual, we can also say the temple. In this immanence cosmology, Spinoza presents in his book, Ethics, the attributes of thought and matter are belonging to the same dimension. That is the strata, that is reality. What is learned from Spinoza's thinking is that strata is correlating to the power of the attributes. That is an abstract dimension parallel to the concrete attributes of thought and matter. This is the reason why Spinoza's philosophy is called parallelism. The consequence of parallelism is a horizontal reality with passages between the attributes. A model of this metaphysics is the fold. Effects are the attributes and the causes are the power of the attributes. Now we are going to look at the four folds. A The phone is power. The phone is power. Quote, the phone is power. Force itself is an act of the phone. End quote. Power is the base of everything existing in reality. Power can be transformed into both thought and matter. Power can emerge into all different forms. The perspective is depending on what form one is situated in. Each type of form is therefore a certain position as a subject or soul. The first form Deleuze is describing is the inflection. Here we have a picture. And this is deriving from Deleuze's original pictures, and I made it from his picture. Through a simple S-form sketch, Deleuze demonstrates how the point of inflection is a point where the concave turns to be convex. Deleuze refers to Paul Klee's studies of faults. Quote, this is the point of inflection itself, where the tangent crosses the curve. That is the point form. End quote. Inflection has two potential curves, the concave and the convex. Two different powers that go in diametrical opposite direction. This point is what Leibniz calls an ambiguous sign. Why is it ambiguous? Because it's not possible to know the outcome of direction from the start, line or point. According to Klee, the point is the beginning, quote, a site of cosmogenesis, or a non-dimensional point between dimensions, end quote. It captures the fundamental conditions of existence, the double forces of development, plus and minus, concave and convex. The first form, the inflection, is thus a vectorial and operates with symmetry. Inflection provides an elementary level of power constructed by tension between opposite powers. The second form is similar to the inflection, but there is a slight change between the curves, it's a distance. Deleuze calls this kind of form the projective or flat projection, end quote. It is depicted as two mirroring curves that have a distance in between them. The space in between the curves is optional. Without the space in between, there is no extension. This is the fault condition of living matter wherein morphology is seen in all things. Quote, fold, the crease, the dovetail, butterfly, hyperbolic, elliptical, and parabolic, end quote. It captures the general mode of existence. So to speak, the conditional spatial mode of existence in Strong. The third fold is a variation of an infinite variable curve known as Cox curve, which is a series of rounding angles. This type of curve, quote, never admits a tangent, end quote. In other words, it remains concave and convexity never gets in. Quote, it envelops an infinity cavaliers or Kuros world, end quote. Deleuze calls these folds Gothic arc and return. Everything changes, he writes, when fluctuation is made to intervene in the place of internal homothesis, end quote. This thought captures an infinite closed space. It is not totally closed, but curvature is only of one kind, concave, a homothesis. How can everything change in this condition? Is it inside the curve the change is made? It is inside the curve the change is made, in other words, it's about a change of mind, a change of consciousness. The fourth fold shifts in another way, one that is a more rare folding. Deleuze writes, transformation or inflection can no longer allow for either symmetry or the phasor plane of the projection. It becomes vortical. This fold seems to avoid the inflection and go the way of spiral. According to Deleuze's description, one arrives at the DNA helix. Quote, the line effectively folds into a spiral, in order to defer inflection in a movement suspended between sky and earth, which either moves away from or indefinitely approaches the center of the curve, and at each instant rises skyward or risks falling upon us, end quote. The fourth form is about power relations between sky and earth, which is another way of saying two powers in a suspension. The line turns to a plane and bends into a spiral. It is two parallel lines that are connected. They never meet but are interrelated through passages. This is now the model of parallelism, a plane of consistency that is twisting to a vortex. No inflection, no concavity, no convexity, no curvature, mirroring. The reversibility is only rendered as a parallel line that is infinitely twisting. After Deleuze provides the basic about the theory of reversibility and the images of four different folds, he brings up the condition of the folds and the relationships between the two dimensions. First, he presents the idea of the objectile. Quote, the new status of the object no longer refers its condition to a spatial mode, and in other words, to a relation to form matter, but to a temporal modulation that implies as much the beginning of a continuous variation of matter as a continuous development of form, end quote. This indicates a continuous development of instinct properties of the mind. This development changes continuously the form of the fold, because the fold is elastic and in constant motion. It is a power that is alive. Deleuze implies that changing things in one dimension reciprocally affects the other dimension. Thus, modulating things in spatiality affects the temporal, or rather to say otherwise, the virtual. Quote, this is not a temporal but also a qualitative conception of the object, to the extent that sounds and colors are flexible and taken into in modulation, end quote. Sounds and color indicate strata. Deleuze continues, the object here is manieristic, not essentializing. It becomes an event, end quote. It's not an essential object any longer. It is an abstraction. It has transformed into an event during the process of folding. However, what is an event? In a parallel reading of Whitehead, event means soul. In chapter 6 of the fold, titled What is an Event?, Deleuze draws the reader's attention to the transformation of the concepts into a subject by referring to, quote, the school of a somewhat secret society in which Plato is a school leader and Whitehead is the successor. One now arrives at what Deleuze calls Baroque perspective, that can be viewed as perspectives. Depending on what fold one is encapsulated in, as a subject or soul, one therefore has that perspective of the reality. Thus, there exist different perspectives which relate to one's temporal or virtual condition. Deleuze introduced here a new concept related to the concavity and Hobbes' curve, namely the point of view. The point of view is a subject's potential in a certain condition. In other words, the potential of the subject that begins first at the third fold, which is a concave curve with no convexity. Stated otherwise, changes in the form of the object make changes in the subject. That is why the transformation of the object refers to a correlative transformation of the subject. End quote. Stated otherwise, changes in the form of the object make changes in the subject. Nevertheless, how can a form be modulated so that the corresponding power of the form is changing? Only through a radical intervention. In the first instance of folds, the subject does not discern the point of view. It seems that this point of view is a condition that occurs first in the development of the subject, on its way to emerge as a soul. Perspectivism does not at all imply subjective relativism. Quote, it is not the variation of truth according to the subject, but the condition in which the truth or the variation appears to the subject, end quote. The point of view is about a condition that is described in other terms as a, quote, proximity to concavity, end quote. From this can be concluded that this condition starts from the third fold. But why does Deleuze make these four categories? And why is the soul presented as gradual in nature? Everything has to do with the finite cause, that is the envelopment. The vortex is also named the envelopment. Now we arrive to spatial distance and virtual proximity. According to Deleuze, Leibniz can define extension as continuous repetition of the situs or position, that is, of point of view. Not that extension is therefore the attribute of point of view, but that the attribute of space, spatium, and an order of distance between point of views is what makes this repetition possible, end quote. This means that the attribute of matter needs distance between the point of views. It is a distance that makes the spatium. Distance is at the third fold, concavity. Deleuze states that the fourth fold is without distance. It is a situs without space, a, quote, non-distance space, end quote. It is a site of proximity. Such a site is temporal or virtual, and its condition is otherwise than from the three-dimensional perspective. To examine more closely the makeup of the folds, first, Deleuze presents a conic section. The top of the cone is a point of view. There is no curve that changes into convexity. Deleuze divides the fold groups into folds of first degree and folds of second degree. The fold of second degree is inflection, whereas the folds of first degree are point of view and development. The point of view is a certain important fold according to Deleuze. Why? Quote, in each area, point of view is a variational or a power of arranging cases, a condition for the manifesting of reality, end quote. The point of view is a point that opens up in relation to the soul. The point of view is a passage to the power of attributes, in other words, to the virtual or temporal. Deleuze continues. We would need a more simple intuition to allow for this passage to the limit, It is an envelope of inherence or unilateral adhesion. Inclusion or inherence is the final cause of the fold, such that we move indiscernibly from the latter to the former. Between the two, a gap is open, which makes the envelope the reason for the fold. What is folded is included, the inherent, end quote. The final aim is envelopment. In order to understand this metaphysics, it seems that one needs to be in the third fold, that is, the point of view. Because it is that site where things change perspective and are not from the same as in the former folds, the inflections. There is a gap between the condition of the third and the fourth fold in terms of perspective seen. Simple intuition is something one might train and develop. If the potential is there, in other words, Deleuze is stating that intuitive knowledge is a capacity for perspective seen. What does this mean in reality, that the envelope is closed? Quote, it can be stated that what is folded is only virtual and currently exists only in an envelope, in something that envelopes it, end quote. This seems to denote that one exists in reality, in strata, as an ordinary person, but what is folded is only virtual, quote. That is to say, the person has a capacity for another perspective, foreseen than those in the first, the second, and the third fold. Deleuze writes, quote, inclusion or inherence has a condition of closure or envelopment, which Leibniz puts forward in his famous formula, no windows, and which point of view does not suffice to explain. It is necessarily a soul, a subject, end quote. No windows means a closed condition. Now we will see all the faults. Deleuze's aim in this theory is to convey a message about the development of the subject or soul as a process of individuation. The transversal from fault to development embraces a development from actual to virtual, but folded within. The subject is a folded force. Moreover, the first two folds are spatial, and the third fold seems to have a capacity for to move between the spatial and the virtual, while the fourth fold is a non-spatial place, a funny temporal condition, but invisibly enfolded in a closure. In order not to understand the development as a state wherein all individuals meld into a universal spirit, Leibniz introduces the monad. The monad is an individual entity and simultaneously an expression for the universal spirit. This name he borrows from the Neoplatonists, who used it to designate the state of the one, a unity that envelops a multiplicity developing the one in the manner of a series. Giordano Bruno brought the system of monads to the level of universal complication, the soul of the world that complicates everything. Deleuze's theory of the fold is a development of this succession. Multiplicity means force. On Deleuze's interpretation, the one envelops force, and reciprocally, the force is developing the one in different series and in different conditions of the fold. The monad is thus a gate, a passage for the universal spirit to transverse the two dimensions, the realm of attributes and the power of attributes. Deleuze contends that immanent plane of consistency is the only way for these transformation and developments to take place. In the power of attributes, there exists only power, which is pure virtuality. In the immanent condition, that is a subject or soul, it is in the immanent condition that we... Okay. So we continue. Serious. Or inflections, writes Deleuze, and the entire world is enclosed in the soul from one point of view. What is the meaning of this series? Each individual is a series of configurations expressed through a singularity. Individuals are variations that undergo many rhythmic and melodic movements. It appears that this refers to a continuous ephemeral development, but Deleuze says they can also follow the contrary or retrograde movement, end quote. As a form of concavity and convexity, development as well can follow a form in two directions, either forward or backward. The individual is a configuration in a series of configurations throughout the plane of consistency that expresses one's soul. However, in the virtual realm and non-space, the soul is a unique entity encompassed by the world soul. Can this understanding become a general knowledge? As I demonstrated earlier, Deleuze indicates that the comprehension of this metaphysical reality is vouchsafed as a condition in the point of view, the sound of the cone, as we read about. Deleuze poses a seemingly elementary question. Why is it necessary to depart from the world or a serial order? Alternatively put, why is all this concealing oblivion? Deleuze's response is simple. Quote, if not, the theme of the mirror and the point of view would lose all meaning, end quote. And I only can admit that this is something to contemplate. Perhaps when it's Kairos, we awake and want to seek the answer, and then we get it individually as a realization. And what is then the soul? The law states that the soul is an effect of this process. And quote, the soul results from the world that God has chosen. Yeah, end quote. In what way has the world chosen the monad? Each monad the world or God has chosen is because of it is nature for God's life through it. The monad is a gate between the spatium and the power of the spatium, that is the virtual. Thus the monad is a sensuous entity that perceives and expresses the development of the world. And finally, the world must be placed in the subject in order that the subject can be to the world. And the last sentence I have to add is the conclusion that the metaphysics of the fold is in fact the pure metaphysics of proximity and sensibility. Thank you.